it's all well and good talking about evaluation and going, this is the right approach to do it, and these are the kinds of questions to ask, blah, 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 blah. But at the end of the day, how on earth on the day do you do it? Okay, so I want to give you a couple of strategies, a couple of suggestions as to how you might get some really useful information about, don't forget, about how to improve your project. Now you will, by accident, get some information about how good your project is. People are just going to tell you, okay? It's like when you wear, I don't know, a new shirt, people are going to say, I think your shirt looks fantastic. When you ask them about how successful your project is, even if they are going to give you a negative review, they're going to tell you the good things. So don't worry about that for the moment. But I want to give you a couple of tools. So there are a number of different ways, and we've talked about qualitative, so story-based, story-based investigation, and quantitative, which is numbers-based investigation. In terms of, you can do both of these in a number of different approaches. So obviously there's a whole bunch of online tools. Now the tools that I would recommend, and you'll find these in the workbook, are Question Pro is one that I use, and you can actually get that for free. Fairly easy to use, fairly straightforward. There's another one, Redcap, but it's a bit more complicated. I'd go with Question Pro. Google Forms is really, really easy, and if you've been using Google Docs, it should be fairly straightforward. SurveyMonkey is another one. I'm not sure what you get for free at the moment, but SurveyMonkey I know is really popular and it works quite well. Now, in saying that, when you have the opportunity to meet people face to face, and I know as I'm filming this, we're under, COVID lockdown, heading in that direction. So who knows what's going to happen over the next 12 months. But when you're in a space with people, you get far more returns of your surveys if you hand them something. Now, that can be a piece of paper. So don't make this overly complicated. It can be as simple as a piece of paper. Just hand them a piece of paper and a pen and say, hey, clipboard, can you give me some feedback? But the digital alternative to that, which means you don't have to decipher their writing, is to hand them a tablet or a phone, okay? And I've done this lots of times. You hand someone something, they're far more likely to give you some feedback. So those online survey tools are brilliant because it means you don't have to write everything down. You get a good set of numbers that you can drop into a spreadsheet. You can do quantitative research, so with the Likert scale that I showed you before, but you can also do qualitative, so where you ask people to tell us about what was the best thing about today and why was it good. Okay, so think about, how you're going to ask those questions. The other thing, when you're designing at the point that you're at now, you're designing a bigger project, is to think about the possibility of doing a focus group or an interview. Now, focus group and interview are just a fancy word for conversation. Okay. Now, a focus group will get together 4 or 5 people, and you'll ask them a series of kind of open-ended questions. And what you're trying to do is to get them to have a discussion among themselves about the answer to your question. Okay, so let's say you put together a gardening group to improve mental health, and you trialed that with, people who were struggling with mental health issues. You'd be mad not to get those people together from your prototype and say, okay, we're going to sit down, we're going to have some pizza, and I want you to tell me about what was your experience of this, and how do you think it helped, and what was difficult about it? And remember that you're really focused on answering your questions, so you need to come up with these to help you achieve your objective. Okay, now you can do exactly the same thing with an interview. So just depending on what you're aiming for. Okay, your project might be something that involves people on their own, or it might be involving groups. So just think about what you're aiming for. An interview can be easier because you don't have to line up 5 people to be available at the same time, but it takes a long time, okay? Now in both of those instances, you can record the audio or just take notes, up to you, but just make sure you get permission before you do that and make it really clear what you will and won't do with that information, because people need to feel comfortable that you're trustworthy with their information. They don't want to see quotes from them in the paper, right? So make sure you do that really ethically. So taking advantage of the fact that you've run your prototype is really important. You've got people who have some rich information, so do not let them escape without giving you their opinion. The other thing to consider is thinking about how you can build evaluative tools into your event. And I'll give you an example, and I think there's lots of ways to do this. An example of this would be, for instance, we ran an event that had multiple entry points. There was no way that we could count people coming in and out, but we wanted to know how many there were, and we ran this over a series of years. So what we did is we gave away a sausage, right? So we didn't know exactly how many people had a sausage, but we kind of estimated that on average, everybody would have one, okay? Because we know that there are some vegetarians, but we also know that there's some greedy guts who's gonna have 3 or 4, and that kid won't eat their dinner. Now, that gave us an estimate, and we called it an estimate, of the numbers of people that we had at the event. And obviously we triangulated that around some other things to make sure that we were getting a kind of a rich understanding of how many people were coming. But sometimes you can get some really good numbers by embedding things into your process. It might be that you get people to take away a show bag, or, you know, what are the different things? So think about how you can use the structure of your event to tell you something about its success. Something to keep in mind when you're counting numbers, because I know that a lot of the reporting that you need to do does need to say what numbers you had, is while you can count the numbers coming through the door really, really accurately, that's not the only important point to pay attention to. So as an example, if I ran a music festival and I had 100 people through the door over the period of a day, that's a small festival, let's call it 500 people through the door over a period of day, but they only stayed for 10 minutes each, my crowd at any one time is going to be tiny. Okay, so thinking about doing a head count, get someone who switched on with numbers, but doing a head count at different points during the day. So you can say, oh, at 10 o'clock we had 100 people, at 12 o'clock we had 400 people, you know, so keeping a track of the bulk of the crowd. The other thing that this speaks to is that if you can keep people for a little bit longer in an event that has an open start and an open end time, you actually increase the size of your crowd without requiring any more people, because they stay there together for longer. So, evaluation. These are just a few tips. Again, you can probably Google this stuff and find out some more ways. The most important thing is to evaluate your core objectives and think really broadly, like we walked you through, really broadly about what success looks like, and then work out how you can either count it, how do you count success, or how do you hear the story of success, okay? And make sure you capture that in a meaningful way. Looking forward to seeing some amazing projects across Victoria. Thanks.